Welcome everyone to our annual program. I want to thank you for coming, and I want to introduce at this time our special guest who came in from the United States to be with us, Rabbi Yisrael Chaim Blumenthal, who actually grew up here in Toronto as a youngster, now living in Lakewood, New Jersey. Rabbi Blumenthal has studied at some of the leading yeshivas in the world, and he writes a weekly column, if you get the Etedna Eman, a wonderful weekly column on the weekly Torah portion. And he's the author of a very important blog called 1,000 Verses. It's on organization is called Judaism Resources. It's an incredibly wonderful resource to people interested in the interface of Judaism and Christianity. So that's a blog called 1,000 Verses. It's highly recommended. We met Rabbi Blumenthal back in 1994, and I want to thank him for his continued support, encouragement, help, friendship. He's been a mentor to us and an inspiration, and it's with great pleasure and honor that I introduce Rabbi Yisrael Chaim Blumenthal.
Thank you, Rabbi Skobeck. Thank you, Julius. Thank you, the staff of Jews for Judaism, for bringing me here today, for giving me the opportunity to share. And thank you all for coming here this afternoon. We have gathered here to discuss the phenomena of Christian missionaries quoting rabbinic literature to advance their campaign for the soul of the Jew. I want to give you an outline of what I plan to do this afternoon. First, I want to explain and illustrate how the missionary quotation of rabbinic literature has affected the dynamic, how it has affected the encounter between the missionary and the Jew, how it changes that dynamic, how it changes that encounter, and what it does to it. In the second segment, I hope to give an overview of the history, the authority, and the structure of rabbinic literature. And in the third segment, we'll get to the fun, the Jewish response to the missionary quotation of rabbinic literature. Now, before I begin, we have to give at least a small identification. What do we mean when we say rabbinic literature? What does that mean? Simple. On simple terms, again, in the second segment, we'll focus on this in more detail, but at this point, I will just say as follows. When I use the term rabbinic literature, what I mean is any literature that the Jewish community respects as valid and authentic religious literature that postdates the Bible, that comes after the sealing of the canon of Jewish scripture. That's what I call rabbinic literature. And that's what I'm talking about over here when I say missionary Christians quoting rabbinic literature to advance the cause of their campaign. This leads us to an immediate question, a very obvious question. When the missionary quotes the prophets, when he quotes the Jewish Bible, we understand what he is doing. We don't agree with what he's doing, but we understand what he is trying to do, what his argument is. You see, all the prophets predated, they came before the advent of Christianity. They were here before Jesus. Christians look at the prophets as men of God. They're authentic prophets. God truly spoke to Isaiah. He spoke to Jeremiah. The book of Esther is divinely inspired. Christians accept that. So they accept the authority of the prophets. They respect the prophets. And their argument is that had the prophets been there when Jesus came on the scene, they would have accepted him. And if you read the words of Isaiah, if you read this passage in the book of Daniel, you'll realize that Daniel really would have believed in Jesus. And the only way we could argue with them is, let's read the passage and discuss the words of Daniel, because by the time Jesus came around, Daniel was no longer alive to tell us what he would say about Jesus. But when we're talking about missionaries quoting rabbinic literature, and almost all of it post-dates Jesus, comes after Jesus has been and gone. So they knew about Jesus, and they rejected him, and they didn't accept his claims. They didn't accept the claims of the church. So what are they doing quoting rabbinic literature in order to advance their campaign, in order to advance their arguments to get us to give our devotion to Jesus. The rabbis rejected Jesus. How can you quote the words of these men in support of a campaign that these men opposed heart and soul? Now, the truth is, when the missionaries quote rabbinic literature, we can basically categorize it into three categories. I'm going to be mainly focusing on the third category, but I'll speak a little bit about the first two categories as well. The first example, the first type of missionary quotation of rabbinic literature is antagonistic. It's a situation where a missionary would quote rabbinic literature not in support of Christianity, but rather to act as a foil, to be a contrast to Christianity. They would quote a rabbi who says such and such, and I'll give you an example in a minute, and the point is, look how foolish, look how wrong, how obviously wrong it is what this rabbi is saying, and now let's contrast that with the teaching of Christianity, which is so obviously true in light, in contrast to the teaching of this rabbi. I'll give you an example for this category, this type of missionary quotation. Perhaps it's the most popular, at least currently one of the most popular ones. Christians believe in the Trinity. The Trinity, in short, is a concept where God is not absolutely one, but rather a composite unity composed of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And those three are somehow one. Now, we all know that the Rambam codified, he put down 13 principles of faith, and one of them is, as it's printed in the Siddur, the Rambam speaks about God being yachid, alone, unique. And Christians say, wait, the Rambam is using a very interesting Hebrew word. He's using the word yachid to express the Jewish concept of absolute unity. God is absolutely one. But when Moses talks about it, he doesn't use the word yachid. He uses the word echad. Oh, so here what they're doing is, by quoting the Rambam, by quoting Maimonides, what the missionaries are doing, they're providing a contrast. The Bible says echad. The Rambam says yachid. Maimonides says a different Hebrew word. So the Jewish people who are following Maimonides are not in line with the biblical truth. Rather, they would argue that the word echad represents a composite unity, and they would quote where the Bible speaks about Adam and Eve getting together, or man and woman getting together, and they will be one, and that's obviously a composite unity. A household is made up of man and a woman. It's two that are somehow one. So the word echad means a composite unity, and that's the biblical truth. In contrast, the Jews are following the Rambam, who is not in line with the biblical truth. So this is an example of Christians quoting rabbinic literature to provide a contrast, not to support their doctrine directly, but rather to provide a contrast to what they're trying to teach. Once I put this Christian argument on the table, I will take the time to respond to it. First of all, it's based on ignorance to begin with, because anyone who knows a little bit about the history of the 13 principles of faith and the way the Rambam wrote them down, the brief statements of faith that are found in the Siddur, in the back of the Siddur, were not written by the Rambam. The Rambam wrote an essay in Arabic, which is printed in the back of the Mishnah in Sanhedrin. He wrote in the Yad HaChazaka in Hebrew about it. And when he writes in Hebrew about it, he uses both the word echad and yachid. And to accuse the Rambam of not fully understanding Hebrew is a bit ridiculous. He was probably one of the greatest scholars of the Hebrew language that we ever had. So it's based on a mistake, because it's not the word yachid, that little statement of faith that we have in the Siddur, is some anonymous writer who just paraphrased the Rambam's principle in a short sentence. Secondly, if you know Hebrew, you'll realize that the word echad means what the word one means in English. It could refer to a composite unity. It could refer to an absolute unity, just like the word one in English could refer to an absolute unity, a composite unity. The word yachid, alone and unique, could refer to an absolute unity and could refer to a composite unity. When we speak of a person being yachid, every human being is a composite unity. He's made up of right and left, front and back, body and soul. A human being is a composite unity. Yet it's completely appropriate within the Hebrew language to use the word yachid to describe a person. The word yachid doesn't mean an absolute unity any more than the word echad means an absolute unity. So this contrast between yachid and echad is an artificial contrast. And finally, just let's step back and look at the big picture. What's going on over here? The Christian would have us direct devotion to a man that didn't live in the times of Moses. When Moses spoke the words to the Jewish people, Shema Yisrael Adonai Eloheinu Adonai Echad, Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. The Jewish people took this as their declaration of faith. Were they thinking about Jesus when he said that? They didn't know about Jesus when he said that. What were they thinking about? They were thinking about the God that they knew. Here the Christians are coming and asking us on the basis of their interpretation of this verse to direct attention, devotion, heart to a person that Moses and the people he spoke to never heard about. So who's being loyal to the Bible? Is it the Christian or is it Maimonides who is encouraging the Jewish people to give their hearts and to put their hearts in the same place that Moses was encouraging his people to put their hearts, in the same place that Moses' audience understood Moses' words when he was telling them where to put their hearts? That was the example for the antagonistic, for the contrast, for the situation where the missionary is quoting rabbinic literature to provide a contrast. The second category of missionary quotation of rabbinic literature, and I would say that this is perhaps the most honest of the types of quotations when missionaries quote rabbinic literature, and that would be in support of a scriptural interpretation. In other words, the missionary is not quoting the rabbis because he attributes any authority to the rabbis. He's not quoting them because he attributes any respect to the rabbis. All he's doing is as follows. We often have a debate, and in our counter-missionary work, we sometimes tend to simplify. It makes things easier when you simplify the argument and you say, this Hebrew word means this, and I'll give an example in a minute, it means this, and when the Christians say it means that, they're being wrong, and then the missionary would counter, and he will say, look, one of the Jewish commentators who you respect gives an interpretation of the verse which accords with our interpretation. In other words, and I'll give the example, Psalm 2. The words in Psalm 2 which the Christians focus on are nashku var, which could be translated as embrace purity, worship with purity, arm yourselves with purity. Most Jewish commentators go in that direction. Christians insist that the words mean kiss the sun, and they understand that to mean worship the sun, give devotion to the sun, and by them, by Christians, the word the sun means Jesus. So, the typical argument and the simplified argument, and I would say perhaps not entirely accurate argument, is that the word bar has to mean purity and it cannot mean sun in this context. But Ibn Ezra, one of the preeminent commentators on the Bible and one of the greatest Hebrew scholars that we ever had, someone who the Rambam, Maimonides, respected greatly, tells us that the word bar, in this case, does mean sun. So when the Christian is quoting the Ibn Ezra, he doesn't have to respect the Ibn Ezra, but he's telling us that our argument is inaccurate, and we have to accept that. We have to realize that we have to explain the verse according to the Ibn Ezra. And of course, the Ibn Ezra did not believe in a divine Messiah. He did not believe in worshiping the sun. But what he did believe in is that there's a concept of paying homage to the Davidic king, giving loyalty to the king from the line of David, and we'll explain that later on in this presentation. But when the missionaries quote the rabbis in support of a scriptural interpretation, we have to pay attention. I will give another example of a missionary quote of rabbinic literature in support of a scriptural interpretation, and this actually is totally mistaken. Perhaps one of the most famous and popular debates between Jews and Christians over scripture is over the verse in Isaiah 7:14. Behold, the virgin shall be with child. Wait, it doesn't say anything about a virgin. The Hebrew word that is used is alma, which does not mean virgin. It means a young woman. Now, one of the Christian arguments in response to this argument is, well, which word would you want the prophet to use to speak about a virgin? And the immediate response is, of course, the word besula, betula, which means a virgin. And the Christian argument in response is to quote rabbinic literature, which tells us, perhaps, or perhaps not, that the word betula does not literally mean a virgin. So let's just put the argument into context. Again, this might be a little bit complicated, but let's try to put it into context. Again, in context, what the Christians are arguing, they're not arguing over here, in this case, that the word alma, the word that the prophet used, means virgin. They acknowledge it does not mean virgin. There is some argument that it might mean that, but it doesn't, and we're not going to get into that argument today. What they are arguing is that there is no alternative word in Hebrew to express the concept of virginity. And they're quoting the Talmud in the tractate Nida, which tells us that the word betula seems to tell us that the word betula does not mean virgin. The tractate Nida discusses the concept of a woman who is young, who's a child, who never experienced a menstrual flow of blood. And it uses the word betula to describe that situation. And it actually used the words, Ezaihi besula, what is considered a betula? Kol shelo ra'asa dam miyameha. She never saw a flow of blood in her life. So the Christians read this as, well, here the Talmud is telling us that the word betula does not mean a virgin, rather it refers to a young woman who is just too young to, she's not mature enough to experience a period. And that's all the word betula means. So the word betula does not mean virgin. That is a terrible mistake, because the word betula does mean virgin, and it could be proven from the Bible. In fact, when the Bible wants to speak about the concept of virginity, it speaks about in the book of Deuteronomy. And it speaks about a woman who is supposed to be a virgin and she gets married. And her husband comes to court and says, my wife was not a virgin. And basically, the Talmud understands this to mean he brings evidence that she committed adultery during her period of engagement. And the word that the Torah uses to discuss the virginity of the girl is bitulim. Not only, it takes the word bitula as a noun and turns it into an adjective to describe the girl. To describe the concept of virginity in and of itself is bitulim. So the word bitula certainly does mean virgin. And when the Talmud says, what is a betula? It means a woman who didn't experience the flow of blood. That's just like we use the word virgin in English to refer to earth that wasn't planted. And the Talmud uses the word virgin for that as well. So when the Talmud says, Ezoi betula, what is a betula? It doesn't mean, how do we define the word betula in the Bible? What is the intrinsic meaning of this word? What the Talmud is telling us in this context, in the context of this local discussion about a woman who does or doesn't have a flow of blood, the word betula means someone who didn't experience the flow of blood. In other words, the word betula as a borrowed term, intrinsically what it means is a virgin, a woman who never had relations with a man. That's what intrinsically the word means, as the book of Deuteronomy tells us. But it's being borrowed, and what the Talmud is telling us, that in this local context, the word betula is being used for a woman who never experienced a flow of blood. In the tractate Bava Basra, the Talmud uses the word betula to refer to earth that hasn't been plowed or trees. They had a system with, for certain wood-producing trees, they would allow them to grow, chop them in a certain way that would make the trees, that would encourage the trees to grow thicker branches and better wood. So a tree before it was chopped would be called a betula. Again, borrowed term. It means a virgin tree. Of course, a tree cannot be a virgin, but we're borrowing the term which applies to a woman, and we're associating it with a tree that was never had never been interacted with. So this is an example of the Christians quoting rabbinic literature in a desperate attempt to support a scriptural interpretation, but it's a misquotation. Now we're going to come to the third category, which is the main topic, the main focus of our discussion this afternoon. And that is when Christians quote rabbinic literature in support of one Christian doctrine, one Christian teaching, or another. I'll go through a list of various Christian teachings that the missionaries use rabbinic literature to support these teachings. And hopefully we'll, in the third section, we'll get to examples of the missionary quotation and the Jewish response to these examples. Perhaps the most pervasive is the concept of a divine Messiah. Jews believe that the Messiah will be a human being born from a human father and a human mother from the line of David, and Christians believe that the Messiah will be divine or half divine. He has God for a father, he has no biological human father. And Christians point to various passages, various statements in rabbinic literature, which either exalt Messiah to such high level of exaltation, which Christians argue would only make sense if we assume he's divine, or they point to passages which speak about God redeeming the Jewish people in the future. Various passages which give an understanding of a divine Messiah. Associated with this type of quotation would be where Christians try to quote rabbinic literature which seems to counter the Maimonides model, Maimonides' expression of faith, where God is incorporeal, has no body. There seems to be quotations specifically amongst the Kabbalists which associates faces with God, plurality with God, corporeality with God, in other words, body-like attributes, and they use these quotations to present support for the Christian teaching that God isn't absolutely one, he isn't absolutely incorporeal, without body, without bodily attributes. Missionaries, another category, another area where missionaries quote rabbinic literature is to support the concept of a suffering Messiah. In a simplistic level, Jews understand that the Messiah will be a glorious king who will come to reign, to rule over a utopian society. But there are statements in rabbinic literature which speak about a suffering Messiah. And missionaries point to that to show how Jews believe in a suffering Messiah, not only in a glorious Messiah. On this one, I would tell you that our view of a glorious Messiah perhaps is too simplistic. In this case, the missionary quotation of rabbinic literature is not so inaccurate, and perhaps we'll get to that as well. Missionaries quote rabbinic literature to support the concept of a rejected Messiah. They try to point to passages in rabbinic literature which would have us believe that the Jews will reject the Messiah and the Gentiles will accept him. That's another Christian teaching that the missionaries point to rabbinic literature to find support for. A fifth concept, atonement through blood. One of the major differences between Protestant Christianity and the Jewish people is how does one achieve atonement? How does one get forgiveness for their sins? According to the Jewish Bible, according to the testimony of the Jewish people, we achieve atonement, forgiveness for our sins, with sincere repentance, turning back to God, accepting that we did wrong, trying to improve in the future, turning around and bring our lives back in line with God, apologizing to God, repenting. Christians counter and argue that no, one can only achieve atonement for his sins with a blood offering. There's a Christian teaching. It has no support in rabbinic literature, no real support in rabbinic literature, but Christians point to various passages, various sentences in rabbinic literature, which at first glance would seem to agree with the Christian teaching that there is no atonement without a blood offering. We mentioned Christians quote rabbinic literature to support the teaching of a virgin birth, a concept that is completely foreign to Judaism. Christians quote rabbinic literature to present an argument in favor of the timing. When does the Messiah have to come? Christians argue the Messiah had to come 2,000 years ago. Jews argue the Messiah will come when he will come. But the Christians point to various passages in rabbinic literature which would lead one in the direction that Messiah did have to come 2,000 years ago, and perhaps we may address some of those. And finally, again, this is not an exhaustive list, but it's on my little list. This is the last one on the list, is Christians quote rabbinic literature in support of their claim that they know the name of the Messiah. There's a prayer in the Rosh Hashanah Machzor which says the word Yeshua in it, and Christians point to that. That proves that the rabbis knew the name of the Messiah, and this is somehow a hint or testimony that Yeshua, which is the Hebrew version of Jesus, according to some, is the real name of the Messiah. So these are basic Christian doctrines, Christian teachings that Christians find support for within the body, the vast body of rabbinic literature. Now here's where we come to our questions. What are they doing? The rabbis were not Christians. The rabbis did not believe in Jesus. So why are they quoting the rabbis in support of their teachings? The rabbis did not believe in a virgin birth. They did not believe that Jesus is the Messiah. They did not believe in a divine Messiah. So why are they quoting rabbinic literature to support their teachings? There are various approaches that the Christians have used to justify their quotation of rabbinic literature, to answer this question, to explain why it is that they're quoting rabbinic literature in support of a teaching that the rabbis did not believe in. The first answer goes back to a debate that took place in Spain 500, 600 years ago in Tortosa, where the rabbis presented the Christian debaters with this question: why are you quoting rabbinic literature in support of your doctrine? Why are you quoting rabbinic literature, quotations from rabbis, from men who did not believe as you do, in support of what you believe? And the response was, is that, listen, the Jewish people possessed the truth way back when, in the times of the prophets, and some fragments of that truth remained with the Jewish people, and the rabbis unknowingly are transmitting those truths without realizing what they're transmitting. And here is an example, and it doesn't sound as foolish as it would appear at first glance. One of the quotations that they used was from a medrash called Tana Devei Eliyahu. Literally, it means, we learned in the yeshiva, or in the base medrash, in the academy of Elijah the prophet. The Talmud relates that there was a rabbi, his name was Rav Anan, who met regularly with Elijah the prophet. And Elijah revealed to him various truths, and these truths are recorded in this medrash, Tana Devei Eliyahu. And when they quoted this medrash, and this is actually the medrash which is related to the timing of the Messiah, the medrash says, in the name of Elijah the prophet, that the history of the world is divided into three periods of 2,000 years. The first period of 2,000 years is emptiness. The next period of 2,000 years, which starts with Abraham, is the period of Torah. And the last period is the period of the times of the Messiah. So here we see, according to say the missionaries, that the prophet Elijah is telling us that Messiah is supposed to come 2,000 years ago. And when the rabbis argued, well, if you don't trust the Talmud obviously didn't understand it the way you understand it, or else they wouldn't have recorded it. And the missionary's response was, I don't care how the rabbis understood it, but they're recording the words of Elijah the prophet. Elijah was a prophet. This is a fragment of truth that the rabbis are unknowingly transmitting. Now, the question I would ask the missionary is, one second, do you believe that Elijah the prophet met with Rav Anan? If he didn't meet with Rav Anan, you trash this whole book. And if he did meet with him, you can assume Rav Anan was a saintly person, and you can assume that Elijah was talking to someone who he assumed understood what he meant. And to say that you, the missionary, who didn't meet Elijah the prophet, understands what Elijah was saying to Rav Anan better than Rav Anan himself, better than the rabbis of the Talmud themselves, is a little bit audacious, a little bit chutzpah, as we would say. The way we do understand this concept of 2,000 years of Messiah is the way the Talmud explains it. These were 2,000 years in which Messiah could potentially appear. We understand that the suffering that we are undergoing now in exile is part of God's program to bring the Messiah. So the program of bringing the Messiah started 2,000 years ago. In fact, Christians would have to acknowledge that the Messiah didn't come 2,000 years ago. In other words, the Messiah that the prophets of Israel spoke of didn't come 2,000 years ago. When the Christians say the Messiah came 2,000 years ago, what they mean is the person who eventually is going to accomplish what the Messiah is supposed to accomplish, appeared 2,000 years ago, and he did part of his job, and he began the program, and the rest of his job will be completed upon the second coming. Fine. So in other words, what they're saying is the program was set in motion and will eventually come, and that's what we believe as well. We believe the program was set in motion. When the Jews went into exile, the program of the Messianic era was set in motion, and these 2,000 years are dedicated to the bringing about of the fulfillment and the culmination of that program. So this was an example of how Christians use the rabbinic literature to support a Christian doctrine without acknowledging, without saying that the rabbis believe in the doctrine, just that the rabbis are transmitting a fragment of truth without realizing what they're transmitting. A second explanation that the Christians have presented to justify their quotation of rabbinic literature is the argument that Judaism changed. At some point in history, Judaism was an open religion. It believed in many of the teachings of Christianity, or at least it allowed for, it was broad enough to allow, it was diverse, and it allowed for different opposing beliefs, including the doctrines, including the teachings of Christianity. And at some point in history, Judaism took a radical turn and went away from those beliefs, those teachings, which at some point in time were considered authentically Jewish. And our quotation of rabbinic literature is to prove that at some time, Judaism did believe in those teachings. The question is, at what point in time did this change take place? At what point in time did Judaism take this violent turn, this turn away from Christian beliefs? Now, one theory, which won't really help the Christian argument, the Christian quotation of rabbinic literature, is a theory which many academics believe, and that is that at the time of the destruction of the temple, Judaism underwent a radical change. While the temple was standing, while the second temple was standing, according to this theory, Judaism was centered on the service in the temple. It was centered on blood offerings, and that was the focus of Judaism, and that was all of Judaism. And when the temple was destroyed, the rabbis, the leaders of the Jewish people, had to come up with something different. They had to come up with an alternative. They had to come up with another focus, and that's why they changed Judaism, and they moved it from the temple to the synagogue, from the temple to the study hall, from the priests to the rabbis, and that's the point in time where Judaism underwent this radical change. I will first say that this is entirely false, simply because if anyone knows anything about the history of the Jewish people during the Second Temple, they will realize that at the same time that there was a temple and a community in the land of Israel, a temple in Jerusalem, there was an even larger community in Babylon. There was a gigantic community of Jews in Babylon. There were many Jews in the diaspora all over, and they didn't have a temple. Of course, some of them would come to the temple occasionally. They would try to come to the temple, but from Babylon to Jerusalem is a long way if you're walking. And that's the general mode of transportation. Most people didn't have cars in those days. And so what was their Judaism? What did it consist of? It was synagogue-based. It was study hall-based. It was based on what Judaism was always based on. Judaism was based on a relationship with God, and the temple was one means of national expression, indeed the central means of the expression of the nation's relationship with God, but it was not the only expression. And every individual Jew personally always had the study hall, the Book of Psalms, his own heart as a place where he could relate to God. The concept of a synagogue, the concept of a study hall, actually appears in the book of Ezekiel in chapter 11, when the Jews went into exile in the time of the prophet Ezekiel, in the time of the prophet Jeremiah, where God says to the Jewish people, I will be their miniature sanctuary in all the lands of their exile, in all the lands of their dispersal. In other words, wherever we go, God is with us. And we're never without a temple, even though we don't have the temple in Jerusalem, and we pray three times a day for the restoration of the temple in Jerusalem, but we have God with us, and no one could take that away from us. That's the first thing I would say about this theory. The second The second thing I would say about this theory as it relates to our discussion this afternoon is that it doesn't help the missionary argument simply because most of rabbinic literature is post-temple. So to quote rabbinic literature in support of the theory that before, while the temple was standing, Jews believed as Christians, rabbinic literature is not going to give you that information because most of rabbinic literature, the Mishnah, the Talmud, the Midrashim, were all written post-temple. There are bits and pieces, there are fragments of rabbinic literature, as we shall see, that existed during the time of the Second Temple, but most of the missionary quotations don't come from those bodies of literature. A second theory proposed by the missionaries to explain at what point in history did it happen that the Jewish people took this violent turn away from these Christian beliefs, which used to be authentically Jewish, used to be part of the mainstream of Jewish thought, is the theory that Judaism developed as a negative reaction against Christianity. It used to be that some Jews believed in a divine Messiah, some Jews didn't believe in a divine Messiah. Some Jews believed that God had a body, others believed he didn't. Some believed in a suffering Messiah, others didn't. But once the Christians took upon themselves the belief of divine Messiah, God could have a body, suffering Messiah, a rejected Messiah, that's when the Jewish people rejected those beliefs. I'll use the words of a prominent missionary to give expression to this theory. The phrase that Dr. Michael Brown coined is, and these are his words, that the Jewish rejection of the Trinity is a result of a gut-level negative reaction to anything Christian. In other words, it's not intellectual. It's just, we recoil. If it's Christian, we have to reject it. And that's how Judaism went away from its Christian moorings. Interestingly, if you look at the history of Christianity, when was it that the church officially adopted the theory, the doctrine, the teaching of the Trinity? It was at the Council of Nicaea. I want to tell you something, people. The Council of Nicaea was plagued with a gut-level negative reaction to anything Jewish. This is not something that I am making up. The official historian, Eusebius, tells us that the Council of Nicaea didn't just discuss and vote upon if God is three or one, but rather they also voted on many other teachings. One of the teachings that they had a discussion about and voted upon was the following. When do Christians, followers of Jesus, observe the holiday of Easter, the holiday which commemorates the crucifixion, the resurrection of Jesus? Now, many Christians were following the Jewish calendar when they celebrated and when they commemorated the resurrection of Jesus simply because Jesus was a Jew, he lived in Israel, he was a practicing Jew, and he celebrated Passover together with all the other Jewish people. So if he was going to be resurrected on Passover, it was going to be according to the Jewish calendar. It was going to be the Jewish Passover. Problem, in those days, the Jewish calendar was not fixed like it is today. The Jewish calendar originally was a calendar that the leaders of the Jewish people, the unified leadership of the Jewish people, would decide upon every month if the previous month had 29 or 30 days. Every year they would come together and decide if the previous year is going to be a leap year, if it's going to have 13 months or 12 months. Jewish people are last minute people. You're not going to be able to plan your Easter party 3 years in advance. You're not even going to be able to do it 3 weeks in advance. You're going to have to wait till the rabbis decide if the previous month has 29 or 30 days, if the year is going to have 13 months or 12 months. And many Christians around the Roman Empire would wait for the decision of the rabbis. And when the rabbis would decide when the new moon is, when the new year is, that's when they would know when their Easter celebration is going to take place. So this is, I can't read Greek, so I can't read Eusebius in the original, but this was the reasoning behind, they rejected that. They said, we're not going to follow the Jewish calendar. We're not going to follow the decision of the rabbis to determine when we're going to celebrate Easter. And this was the reasoning behind it. It wasn't some esoterical, spiritual reason. It wasn't based on hard study of the Bible. That's not what it was based on. The argument was as follows. Why should we follow in the footsteps of these people who are scorned by God? In other words, why should we follow in the footsteps of the Jewish people who are rejected by God to celebrate our holy festival together with them? Is there any greater impertinence than this? In other words, to them, this was the greatest chutzpah that they could have towards Jesus, that these hated Jews should be able to say that we cannot celebrate and observe our festivals unless we follow their calculations. This is an English translation of what went on in the Council of Nicaea. So this Council of Nicaea, which came to the decision of when they should celebrate their holiday, basically based on a gut-level negative reaction to anything Jewish, also voted on the Trinity. Now, I wasn't there, so I can't argue for certainty that the vote in favor of the Trinity was associated with a gut-level negative reaction to anything Jewish, but to say that the Jewish rejection of the Trinity is based on a gut-level negative reaction to anything Christian is chutzpah. It's audacious, it's arrogant, and it's wrong. A third theory, a third timing for when it is that the Jewish people took this radical turn, this violent turn away from Christian teachings, and the one that actually, historically at least, would be the most helpful to the Christian usage of rabbinic literature would be to blame Maimonides, the Rambam. Maimonides is the bad guy. He was the one that studied Greek philosophy, and he took the concepts of Greek philosophy, and he integrated into Judaism, and he came up with the 13 principles of faith, and that steered Judaism away from its biblical moorings, and most of the quotations of rabbinic literature predate the Rambam, and we're following a pre-Rambam view of Judaism, and what Jews, modern Jews today, are following is a post-Rambam, a hijacked Judaism. A Judaism that was hijacked by Maimonides and by those people who respected and followed him. That's another theory. This is a theory that's not as easy to deal with as the previous theories. It's not as obviously wrong, but one way, superficially again, in the third segment, we'll get to responses to the Christian quotation of rabbinic literature, but in short, we would say, is that missionaries find the same quotations in pre-Rambam rabbinic literature, they find it in post-Rambam rabbinic literature. In the words of the Rambam himself, they find support for their doctrines. So this has nothing to do with pre-Rambam, post-Rambam. This has to do with misreading the text. If you want to tell me that was the Rambam who moved Judaism aside, why does he have these quotations? Why does post-Rambam Judaism have these quotations? Obviously, you're not reading these quotations correctly. But these were three segments or three alternative modes for the theory that Judaism changed. The final theory is as follows. In other words, we're answering the question, what do Christians mean when they're quoting rabbinic literature? Didn't the rabbis reject Jesus? And here is the insidious one, the one which many Christians believe sincerely, is that Judaism, even today, is a diverse religion. There are many streams within Judaism. There are Hasidim, and there are opponents to Hasidim. There are people who believe in the Kabbalah and adhere to it, and people who oppose the Kabbalah or don't emphasize the Kabbalah. And they present their views as a part of Judaism. We are more Hasidic, Kabbalah inclined, and you counter-missionary activists are Rambamists, rational Jews, misnagdim, anti-Hasidim, and we represent a stream in Judaism which is valid and authentic and alive today. A slight variant of this is the fantastic theory that the followers of Jesus, we know were Jews, but we also know that at some point the Gentile church eradicated the Jewish followers of Jesus, swallowed them up, persecuted them as heretics. But this theory goes is that throughout history there have always been Jewish followers of Jesus, and these people are following pre-temple Judaism, they're following Judaism as it was in the times of Jesus, and these people are being bullied into submission and silenced by the establishment, the rabbis, the leadership of the Jewish people who wants conformity, who wants political power, and this plays right into the general feeling that we have to go for the underdog versus the establishment, to go for the weaker one versus the bully. And there's another theory proposed by missionaries to justify their quotation of rabbinic literature. A fourth way of presenting this concept about this stream of Judaism that is still alive today is presenting the counter-missionary argument as if it's just simplistic. We're just dumbing it down. This is counter-missionary Judaism, as if there's two Judaisms. Counter-missionary Judaism and there's real Judaism. There's simplistic Judaism versus sophisticated Judaism. If you're a sophisticated Jew and you're a well-read Jew, if you read Mark Shapiro's book on the limits of Orthodox theology, which is a book which speaks about the 13 principles of faith and attempts to show how they were not universally accepted. And if you read such books and you read rabbinic literature with an open eye and open mind, you'll realize that Judaism is much more diverse and much more open than the rabbis today would have you believe, than the establishment rabbis would have you believe, than the counter-missionary activists would have you believe. And we're just a little bit more sophisticated than those simplistic and dumb counter-missionaries. Now, this set of arguments, and particularly the last one, is very insidious and represents a real change in the dynamic, in what was going on in the encounter between the missionary, between the church's campaign for the soul of the Jew, for the heart of the Jew, over the ages. The campaign started out, we'll start with the Gentile church, which is they usurped our prophets, they took our prophets, they usurped our promises, but they said, you guys keep your religion, keep your observances, keep anything Jewish. We just want your prophets, we want your promises, and that's what we're going to take. At some point, last 50, 60 years, they said, no, I think we want some of those observances as well. We want some of your culture as well. And now what they're doing is, we want your community as well. They want the credibility of belonging to our community. And not all of it is insincere. Some of the people really believe that they truly belong in the community. They really believe the story that they're selling. They really believe that this is an authentic, on the basis of their reading of rabbinic literature, they believe that, yes, this is the sophisticated and the real understanding of Judaism, and it's just simplistic and narrow-minded to exclude them from the community. It affects the dynamic in a very serious way, because one of the most powerful arguments that we as counter-missionary activists would use, not to persuade the potential convert to leave Christianity, but to open his mind to the argument, is as follows. Messianic Jew walks in and he says, I'm a Jew, I call myself a Messianic Jew, and I believe in Jesus. And I'm very proud of the name Jew. So 20 years ago, what I would have told him is, I would have asked him the following question. Who gave you the name Jew? You didn't buy it in the store. You inherited that name. Do you realize how much blood, how much suffering went into that? It wasn't easy for your grandfather to give you that name. It wasn't easy for your great-grandfather to give you that name. You owe it to your great-grandfather to find out what that word Jew meant to him. And this would be something that appealed to people, and it would be something that they understood. And they said, yes, I don't know too much about what my grandfather, what my great-grandfather, what my ancestors believed about being a Jew. It behooves me, it's right for me to find out more. But now that the missionaries have adopted the quotation from rabbinic literature, not only the quotation from rabbinic literature, but our observances, our culture, our garb, and they come and say, I look the same like your grandfather. You don't know what your grandfather believed. He might have been a Hasidic Jew. He might have been a Kabbalistic Jew. He might have believed in the teachings that I'm trying to sell you. So this cuts off the door, closes the door. It closes the avenue of research, the reason why a potential convert would look more deeply into the question. There's a double-edged sword over here. We all know that Christianity has been the source of immense suffering for the Jewish people. Why? To put it simply, Jesus never claimed to be the Messiah predicted by the Greek oracles. He never claimed to be the Messiah hoped for by the people of Rome, of Italy. He was the Messiah predicted by the Jewish prophets. He was supposed to be the man that the Jewish people are waiting for. the biggest argument against the Christian claim for the Messiahship of Jesus is the Jew. Not the Jew saying anything, the Jew being a Jew and just ignoring Jesus. One second. This is the man that prays three times a day for the restoration of the Davidic kingdom. He's the man that prays three times a day for the Messianic era to be ushered in. He's looking forward to that. Why does he reject your Jesus? Why does he ignore your Jesus? That is a question that Christians had to deal with. And the solution they came up with, and if you read the New Testament, you will see that this is what they did. What they did was they dehumanized the Jew. The question is based on a premise. In other words, why is the Jew rejecting Jesus? It's based on the premise, well, if Jesus is truly the Jewish Messiah, then the Jew should accept him. That only makes sense if the Jew is a type of person that submits to the truth, that bends to the truth. When he sees that the truth is here, he walks towards it. But John teaches that no, the Jew is not such a type of person. You might be such a type of person, but the Jew is not such a type of person. The Jew, when he sees truth, he turns around and walks the other way. He hates truth. He's a child of the devil. You can't ask me the question, why is it that the Jew rejects Jesus? He knows the truth, but he rejects it anyways, because he's anti-God. Now, thankfully, many people in the church walked away from this attitude that's canonized in the book of John. Rather, they say the Jews don't really know. If they would truly know Jesus, they would truly be presented with the real background of Jesus, they would accept him. But now, with the onset of Christian quotation of missionary literature, we're going back to the old model. We're finding quotations in missionary literature, and I'm talking about missionaries that don't call themselves Christians, missionaries that call themselves rabbis. They're going back to the model, the Jews know the truth and they reject it anyways. They see Jesus in this verse, they see Jesus in this passage, and they reject it anyways. That's a double-edged sword. It's another effect that the missionary quotation of rabbinic literature has on the dynamic of the encounter between the missionary and the Jew.